I counted the other day approximately how much time it took to make this movie. I think it was about 1,000 days, which is a very long time. And if you thought that it was going to be that long when you started, you probably wouldn't even start. I had been working for 3 years without getting a cent in salary. But every day it was worth it because I felt that I held like a gold mine in terms of the story. The story was the best story I ever heard, and the music was some of the best music I ever heard. And then the film, I would, you know, that was my responsibility, and I had never done a film before. And sometimes I felt maybe I'm not the right guy for this. Maybe we need someone a little bit more experienced, because we should not screw this up. It needs to be done properly.
The interesting thing is actually that I get the feeling that Malick sort of learnt his lessons from Rodriguez while he was making the film. You spend 3 or 4 years making a film, you spend every day of your life thinking about the themes of that film, and I guess you end up sort of living by those.
I think what it's all about is to keep your integrity. I mean, why is Rodriguez so good? Because in those songs there is so much integrity. People asked him to do things in another way. You should change your name, shouldn't be called Rodriguez, you should be something more American sounding. And he said, no, wait, this is me. He did the things the way he wanted. That's also why people really like it, because in the lyrics you hear the integrity in every single word. It's his voice, it's nobody else's voice. And I think that's very much the way you should do a film. Always people tell you how to do it. I know better than you do how your film should be. Maybe they do. Maybe their film would be better than yours. But then it's not yours anymore and it's no fun. You need to really care about every single detail. You need to be in love with it. You should try to do it the way you want to do it. And it will take maybe a longer time and it will maybe be much more sacrifices and you won't get salary for a very long time. But in the end, it's probably going to be worth it because it's your dream. And your dream is the only thing you have in the end.
Sugar man, won't you hurry? 'Cause I'm tired of these scenes.
In 2006, I was traveling around Africa and South America looking for stories, like scouting for stories, trying to sell them for Swedish TV. It was such an extremely inspirational trip. But to find stories is difficult. It's something magical about a really good story. And then in Cape Town, I met Steven Sugar Seegerman. And he told me this story, and I was like, wow, this is the best story I ever heard in my life, and probably ever will hear. The film is about a man who didn't know he was famous, basically. It's about an artist who makes an album in the 70s in Detroit, which is a masterpiece.
He's my most memorable artist.
Bob Dylan was mild to this guy.
And the album is released with great anticipation, and to everybody's shock, it's a complete failure. I mean, it sells literally nothing.
How many records do you think he sold in America?
In America, 6.
But this album somehow got to South Africa, and in South Africa, he literally became more famous than the Rolling Stones, selling 10 times platinum, becoming one of the icons forever and ever, and he still is. What attracted me to the story was that it had this kind of structure that normally you only find in fiction. If this would have been a script written by a screenwriter, you wouldn't even believe it, because it's almost too good to be true. A man who lives his whole life in absolute poverty without knowing that in the same time he's a superstar.
Thanks for keeping me alive.
It's a Cinderella story. It really is. It's probably better than Cinderella because Cinderella didn't have as good soundtrack. I would never ever find a better story, so I better do this one really carefully. So in 2008, I went traveling around the world to find the stories that make a man. Who is this man? Who is Rodriguez?
Well, the film is spread all over the world. So the first problem was to just find the people, because this story happened in the early 70s, it's 4 years ago. And many of these people hadn't spoken about this thing for 40 years.
And I thought that they wouldn't remember him maybe, or they would be dead. But they were all alive. And they did remember him.
So this is it, yeah? There we go.
And they didn't just remember him, they were like,
holy shit.
Please, come, I'll give you as much time as you want, just come here. I've been waiting for this phone call for 40 years. No one had ever asked him about Rodriguez before.
Wow, I've never seen this ever. Where'd this come from?
South Africa.
Steve Rowland, the producer in Palm Springs, he didn't even know that Rodriguez was big in South Africa.
I can't believe that this album didn't do anything.
No one had told him that.
Yeah, about South Africa. What is the story?
Yeah, the story is, you hadn't heard anything.
I never heard anything about it, no. Since the day he left, which was in the 70s, early 70s, to now, I hadn't heard a word about him. Not one word.
Because what happened was, maybe we should do that now. Are we running?
This was one of the big mysteries of their lives. How come that Rodriguez never happened? They knew that they had been part of something really special in the early 70s. It was the best thing we ever did. And it sold nothing.
So for some of them, it's like actually the first time they ever learned about what they did 40 years ago actually was something very, very good.
Yeah. And it was so beautiful to see that. Clarence Avant was also like that. Please come meet me. I'd love to talk about Rodriguez.
That's him. That's Rodriguez.
He loved Rodriguez so much. He says that, you know, he's been working with all the great artists. And he said Rodriguez is top five.
This is my man. Man, they'll get me emotional again. Shit.
And Clarence was very extremely welcoming and loved to talk about Rodriguez. Then he when I asked about money, he didn't really want to answer. But, you know, it's a very long time ago. It's 40 years ago. Who knows what happened? Who knows? I thought that the money part needs to be at least mentioned because it is the reason why Rodriguez didn't know he was famous. But it could have been another film.
Here's a guy who's been cheated out of almost his entire artistic venture. That's the biggest crime in the country.
We still don't know what happened to Rodriguez's money, and Rodriguez still sells gold in South Africa. Only the last 5 years is what another gold is. And he still doesn't get a cent. And that's something that we should try to figure out. Why doesn't he get paid now? When I first found the story and I started work on it, I was even worried to listen to the music. They told me that it was great, but I thought it can't be as good as the story. And if it's not as good as the story, I will lose momentum because I fell in love with the story so much. But then I first heard a few songs at Sugar's place. Jesus Christ, this is just one of the most beautiful songs I ever heard. I wonder how many times you've been had, and I wonder. It made sense, those comparisons to Bob Dylan. When you make a comparison to Bob Dylan, it's ridiculous, you know. Bob Dylan is considered as maybe the greatest artist there ever was. But when I heard this album, I thought it makes sense.
You know, normally it takes you three or four times listening to a song to think, wow, that's a great song. The second he opened his mouth, the second he started singing, it gets through to your bones. So the film is infused wall to wall with this incredible music and these incredible lyrics. And the fact is, what we're doing is bringing his music to the attention of a lot of people who actually have no idea about it.
I think if you compare music to film, I think music is by far the more powerful art form. A filmmaker tried to portray other people's lives, but music kind of portrays your own life. It gets inside yourself. The fans in South Africa said, "We made love to your music, Rodriguez. We made war to your music, Rodriguez." And that's what happens with really good music. It gets inside yourself, and it stays forever.
There is a great responsibility when you're telling someone's life story, especially someone who's still alive, that you get it right and that you do it justice.
Rodriguez was reticent, as I'm sure most people might be, but I guess maybe him in particular, when approached by someone asking to make a story about their life.
So Malick decided that he had to go to America to try and find Rodriguez, and he needed to try and persuade Rodriguez that he really understood his story, that he had a real love of his music, and that if Rodriguez worked with Malick, he would be able to make a remarkable film about him.
I remember that I was very nervous because I had heard so much strange and conflicting stuff about him. It was almost surreal. I had so much mythology.
And there were a lot of rumors about him through the years. The first one I ever heard was that he was working at a gas station somewhere in the middle of America. Then there was one that he'd been in prison because he'd killed his lover or wife.
We all believed he was blind.
I heard it was because someone threw acid in his eyes.
We didn't know how tall he was because he was sitting cross-legged.
And then there were the stories of other records that he'd recorded that couldn't be found. So it was kind of the lost tapes kind of vibe.
One of the producers talked about him as a seer, that he was like, he saw things.
That's a crystal ball. I had this idea. I said, let's put Rodriguez in a crystal ball, because I consider Rodriguez a seer.
It's not just a talent. He's like a wise man, a prophet. He's way beyond just being a musical artist.
Then there were also all the ways he was supposed to have died, and there were lots, but the more popular one was this one that he had shot himself on stage.
I heard he reached down and pulled up a gun and pulled the trigger.
Yeah,
we're close.
But there was even a better one that I heard, that he went on stage and he took a can of petrol and he poured it all over himself and took a box of matches and set fire to himself, and like a Buddhist monk, he burnt himself to death in front of his audience.
You know, he became almost this kind of surreal person. And I was like, who is this guy? And I met him, and he was just like exactly what you could ever dream of. The way he looked, you know, he was completely this rock star guy. He was dressed in black, and he had so much charisma, and he was so mysterious, and he was so humble, and everything was so likable. You fall in love with this man.
The relationship between a director and the key subject of a documentary is a very, very key and very important relationship, and requires an extreme level of trust.
I felt guilty because I felt that he didn't like the camera.
You're gonna film it?
Someone is trying to tell your life story.
Please, show it. Okay.
I think it's a very stressful thing for anybody, and Rodriguez, who is a very private man, for him it's even worse.
Rodriguez, okay, if you don't want to do it, we don't do it. No problem. Thank you very much, Rodriguez.
Sometimes I thought, I skipped this. I make this film without Rodriguez, and it would be pretty good as well, I thought. But in the end, you know, you want to see this man, you want to hear him. I needed him on camera, but it took a lot of time.
It speaks to Malick's sort of persuasive abilities, and they are ample, that he was able to not just persuade Rodriguez, but genuinely win his trust.
Perfect. Thank you very, very much.
And genuinely demonstrate to Rodriguez that he had the passion and commitment and ability to do what he said he was going to do.
Very good.
Malick spent a lot of time with Rodriguez. They really grew to know each other well and really love each other.
I'm so glad to see you here in Detroit. It's Detroit is the only city in America with no view, you know?
The first time we came was in the spring, but then I didn't even try to interview him. But 6 months later we came back, and then this time we're gonna have an interview with Rodriguez. We're gonna try to do it. And he was very reluctant. I think we came on a Monday, and every day we asked for this interview, and in the end it came on Sunday, I think he showed up.
Whenever you're ready.
Okay.
But then we got this interview, and it looks the way it looks.
Is this all right? Should I be doing something, though? Should I have a glass of water or something? Yeah, it's supposed to be comfortable.
It's very short, it is. And I ask more questions maybe than he replies.
So run the question to me again, just so I can hear it in my head.
In those days, he really was not used to do interviews in front of a camera. He really didn't like that. He was literally like turning his body like this during the interview, like turning away from the camera, just like he did on stage, which was, I mean, that's him, and in a way that was beautiful.
But wouldn't it have been nice to know that you were a superstar? Well, I don't know what to respond to that.
It's strange now, because now he's doing a lot of interviews, and everyone gets more than I did. And now I feel like a lousy journalist. But I don't think it would have been better if Ruiz has told his whole life story, and you know, because that's not who he is. He's not, you know, bragging about this or talking about how horrible everything was, or, you know, that's not him. And many people say, oh, we wanted more of Rodriguez. But in a way, I think it keeps his mystery in this movie, and maybe that's the way it should be.
This story almost feels like a fairy tale, so we wanted the visual expression to go along with that. We first of all wanted to make a beautiful and a dynamic film with a feeling of a constant movement.
Well, you're shooting a music video.
No, it's a documentary film about Rodriguez.
Okay.
So it's going to be tell us the 1.5 hour of the full story.
So every location and every action is carefully chosen. It's more like shooting a feature film, but with real characters and a real story.
Fantastic, wow.
Just by pure chance, this film is set in two very cinematic places. It's in South Africa, which is like a summer, you know, it's beautiful and it's always sunshine. And then it's Detroit, which is this hard, almost apocalyptic, cold city. And this contrast makes kind of the film, those two worlds are like struggling with each other in the film. One of the big challenges of the story is that most of the story already happened. It's a retelling, and nothing was filmed. I mean, most of it were never filmed. Rodriguez's life has never been filmed. So we use a lot of animation to show that life, that world, that we couldn't be able to see otherwise. It's almost like a fairy tale, and the animation almost like a saga, and the animation makes that kind of almost surreal feeling. You don't really know if it is true or not, and it is true.
And we also worked with a Super 8 camera, since we did not have a lot of archive footage from the 70s, so we have to recreate that feeling.
The film was basically a almost no budget production. We had very little money. But in the end, even the money for the Super 8, we ran out of that money. So in the end, I used my iPhone, the Super 8 app on the iPhone. And actually, there are a few scenes, like the first bar scene in the film, where Rodriguez is discovered in this bar, is made with the Super 8 app.
Malik?
Yes?
The fact that there is very little archive of Rodriguez, very little picture material, could present a huge challenge for a filmmaker. But remarkably, Malik, as a director, very skillfully and very creatively, enables us to get a really strong sense of the man, despite the fact that there isn't that much material of him.
The inspiration for the tracking shots in Detroit is Rodriguez himself.
Basically, when you spoke to people in Detroit, almost everybody had the same story.
He was this wandering spirit around the city, and it just added to this mythology of him. Like, well, what is he doing?
Rodriguez is this wandering spirit, always dressed in black, this mysterious shadow walking the streets of Detroit, and that image caught my imagination. There was a very cinematic feeling about that.
And now we go in the same speed.
So we drove around a lot in Detroit to get this filmic feeling. And sometimes it was a little bit dangerous.
Come inside! Woo!
Jump in the bed, buddy.
Are you completely soaking wet?
Well, I did it.
Yeah. Holy smoke!
When the film was 90% finished, suddenly the main funder dropped out. The film isn't good, they told me. And that's very hard as a filmmaker. But then I was like, no, but wait, this is good. And he thought it was good 2 months ago. He just changed his mind. He had promised exactly what we needed to finish this movie. We needed animation, I needed original music, and I needed someone who edited the movie. And I didn't have that. And I had, at that point, been working for 3 years without getting a cent in salary. So all my savings were gone. I started to borrow money from people, and I came to a situation where I literally couldn't work. I mean, I needed food, I needed clothes, and I stopped. I literally gave up. And I thought I was giving up for forever, because I thought, this is it. Without this, I can't finish. And I was really depressed. And then I was thinking, okay, so what can I do? I don't have money, I can't pay people, can I try myself? So I tried to do those animations, or I actually simplified it to just illustrations, like with a chalk and white paper, very simple stuff. And I did the same with the music. I bought a Logic Express for like 100 euros. And I did like a score on my laptop. And I did the same with the editing. I edited it as good as I could. Sometimes I stayed home instead of going out Friday nights and Saturday nights just editing.
Malik had essentially been working on it on his own, kind of in his kitchen. And he sort of hit a bit of a wall, I think, in terms of, you know, how he was going to finish it.
I needed help, I thought, and I'd fallen in love with Man on Wire. I thought it was a brilliant film, and I thought that the guys who made Man on Wire probably understands this one. And then I called Simon Chin, the producer of Man on Wire. I called his office, and I told the receptionist, if you just give me 3 minutes with Simon Chin, I will tell him a story that is better, or as good, I think I said, as Man on Wire.
He sort of bounced into my office. He's got this kind of great energy. I think his pitch was, it's about a guy who didn't know he was famous, which I guess is a pretty intriguing thing. And then he left me with a rough cut that he'd clearly been working on for some time. I was watching it on my little computer in my office, wondering what it is exactly I was looking at. Are you ready? It was great. I got goosebumps.
Simon Chin put the DVD on my desk and said, this just came in out of nowhere. And about 65 minutes later, I was in tears.
I thought, this is special, you know, and how can I not get involved in this?
Searching for Sugar Man is a sort of extraordinary directorial feat, and Malik should be an inspiration for young filmmakers and aspiring filmmakers, because here is someone who was just hell-bent on making his first film.
He totally believed in it. To the extent that he was prepared to literally give up 1,000 days of his life. When he didn't have the money, he said, fuck it, I'm gonna write the score, I'm gonna do the animations, I'll do the illustration. Can't afford an editor, I'll figure out how to cut the film myself. I don't think he'd cut a film before in his life. That, I think, is what it takes to be a good filmmaker. That kind of tenacity and dedication that Malik showed. I think Rodriguez and I actually feel really proud.
Okay. Premiere time.
Yeah, there you go.
Okay. This is the premiere night. The premiere night. After, hooray!
After 4 years. How do you feel?
Good.
This is a big name. This is
an athlete. Thanks for having me. Hey, Craig.
Hey.
Where are we now?
Is that camera or
film? It's a camera. It's filming.
Oh, no.
You know, yeah, you didn't like to be here.
Are you okay? Or?
Sure. Come here. Where are we now?
Oh, du vet fan, alltså.
We are in the press. You're going to go to the press line, right?
Yeah.
Yep.
Yep. Freezing!
It's freezing cold here.
We are entering to the...
For the first screening of Searching for Sugar Man. But thanks for your time.
Then you can... Thank me for mine. The response in Sundance was really phenomenal. It was one of those films that happens there every now and then where audiences literally, you know, were crying and cheering.
And no one had any idea that Rodriguez was going to be there. We very deliberately kept it a secret.
Please get on your feet, all the way from Detroit. Rodriguez!
The response was just... huge.
Since Sundance, Malik and Rodriguez have been on a global tour. They've been traveling the world, supporting the film, playing concerts.
Maybe this is what he wanted, you know. He's an artist, and an artist wants to get his stuff out there. And now he's actually out touring.
Rodriguez did his artistic moment, which was stunning. An explosion, and didn't get any reward for it.
This guy deserves recognition.
For us as producers, it's really gratifying to see him going through this moment where everyone is listening to him, and everyone does want to hear him play the songs that those South Africans fell in love with all those years ago, and that people are falling in love with in the movie.
It's amazing to see. He wants to get in front of an audience and perform. That's who he is.
the Detroit artist trying to break into the American market after conquering South Africa. The American music media is heralding his 38-year-old album Cold Fact as a lost soul classic.
I think with documentaries in particular, you're hoping for a sort of greater resonance with something in the air or in the zeitgeist. And I think Searching for Sugar Man feels like so much more than just a music film.
Yes, it's a film about a musician, but it's a film about life. It's a film about the human spirit.
Yeah, and the air, see? It sounds so real. It's amazing. You know, this is our first step for me, so I mean, really, it's crazy, you know? All right, here we go. Tell me where exactly I speak to. Thank you so much, sir. See, that's technology, right? I feel like an astronaut.
Hey, here we go.
That for me has been the sort of great revelation of working on this film, is that when I met Rodriguez and spent time with him, you know, he is exactly as you find him in the film. He's a great kind of example for everyone, but I guess he's also, I suppose particularly I've always felt a kind of example for people living through hard times, and we're going through hard times at the moment.
What's your life been like?
Well, I'm from a hard working class background, and the thing is, I do demolition, renovation, restoration of residents and stuff like that.
He lives a very, very, very modest life.
The source of his riches seems to be from elsewhere, from staying true to himself.
Just because people are poor or have little doesn't mean that you know, their dreams aren't big and their soul isn't rich.
It becomes then a film for our particular times. But for me, fundamentally, it's a story about hope. Anyone who's kind of toiled in their lives, who has talent that hasn't been recognized, should go and see this film. It's like almost the kind of reverse of the X Factor. It's that if you stick to your guns, if you carry on with integrity, honing your craft, if you live a good life, that maybe, just maybe, if you're lucky, maybe you'll realize your ambitions.
Can this be your life now, 38 years after making the record?
Well, I got my fingers crossed and I knock on wood, man. You know?
Well, isn't this all our great fan? Your dreams of yourself, the higher forms of yourself, is that one day you will be recognized. Most of us die without coming anywhere close to that sort of magic.
If you just do what your dreams are, maybe you won't get what you want immediately. Maybe it takes a long time. Maybe you will never get it. But in Rory's case, he actually did get it. It took a long time. And when he got it in a big way, because what he did was flawless. His creative output was flawless because he kept the integrity. Any artist should think about those things, that you can always get a little more money somewhere if you do compromises, if you do what they tell you to. But in the end, it won't be better. The only piece of art that is really interesting anyway is the thing that comes from someone's heart.
He had this kind of magical quality that all genuine poets and artists have, to elevate things, to get above the mundane, the prosaic, all the bullshit, all the mediocrity that's everywhere. What he's demonstrated very clearly is that you have a choice. He took all that torment, all that agony, all that confusion and pain, and he transformed it into something beautiful.
That's really what Rodriguez is proving, that you can do your life, you can live your life the way you want to. And maybe you won't get all the material stuff that other people would have, but who, if you think about it, what is it that you really want to do? Do you want to be somebody who stands up for something and who actually creates something that is, in Rodriguez's case, maybe it's going to be eternal? It's that good. And why is it that good? Because it has this integrity. Because it isn't a sellout. Because it's true.